Hey, what's going on, guys? Nathaniel Evans. I'm Adata. I'm with Gene again. We're talking about life insurance, but different aspects of life insurance. This time, we're actually going to be focused on life insurance because of what's happening out here in society. A lot of youths are actually losing their lives through gun violence, through different diseases that's out here. You know, especially COVID is taking a lot of lives, and we just want to spread light on why this is so important to just understand what the elements of life insurance is and how it can actually protect your family, and being aware of the changing times and unnecessary loss of life, and that unnecessary loss of life can bring a real hardship on the families. So we actually looking in, you know, into this on a, from a different perspective, not just, you know, people buying life insurance, but understanding the elements and the changes that's taking place in society and why it's important to actually be able to protect yourself, you know, from the inevitable. You know, we are not psychics. We don't know what's going to happen from today to tomorrow. And statistics do not lie. And if we look at statistics, we will see that there's high death rates that's taking place all over the world, New York, you know, and other regions, and that our youths are actually caught up in the midst of this whole process. So I'm actually looking forward to having this conversation with Gene. We're only going to give y'all like a half an hour today, and to help us do this, and we can help one another, because these are trying times for all of us, and we want all of us to be successful. Everybody has to win. We want everybody to win, even though they say the win-win concept is not realistic, but it is when we actually dealing with human life. So with that, I actually pass on the segment to Gene and let Gene work his magic.
Thank you, Nathan. Thank you for having me. I do appreciate it. It is a very important subject that needs to be addressed and is not currently being addressed, that needs to be enacted and acted upon. It is very important to know that that we need to be very aware as to what is happening in our society and the changes in our society and how it affects us as a people. One of the things that we need to be concerned about is that, and a lot of people are not concerned about, but they need to know, and I feel they need to know, because life insurance is not new. Life insurance is not spoken about at the dinner table amongst family, because a lot of people don't like to speak about death or the inevitable. Okay, they would speak about a new car, they'll speak about a new job, but they wouldn't speak about the things that are very, very important and matters. So in the 1700s, Benjamin Franklin made a statement about insurance. But today, my thoughts on of the day for the public, for the world, says, did you know more deaths in the winter and fewer deaths in the summer? Is well established and long-running public mystery. Did you know that? It's a well-established mystery that more people will die in the winter. Now, as we enter into the summertime, we're finding that statistically, there's more people driving and there's more people getting involved in accidents. And with those accidents, all are not road fatalities. They are more gun negligence, there's more violence, okay? And they're also categorized as accidental death and murder. Where does the family stand in getting the protection they need when a younger person die? I mean, all people die is a problem, but what happens when a younger person die? And when I say younger, 40 and below, from 40 to birth, okay, where are we with that? And how do we handle that going forward? It's very, very important that we think about how we handle that and structure that correctly so we plan for the future. One, when a child is newly born, the younger the child, the cheaper the insurance, the bigger the policy. Okay? It's very important. Of course, as parents, you don't want to profit from your children's demise. But at the same time, it can help you create a legacy in aid of that child that passed from life to eternity or have accidentally died, okay? It can help you with so many different things, including giving them a proper, respectable funeral without having a burden onto society and the community at large. So it's very important that we think about those and be able to do that. Now, some carriers versus others in the insurance industry in high crime areas tend not to cover younger children. And that's something that needs to be addressed, okay? Because there's some companies that start coverage from age 18 and not for the grave, and while other companies carry coverage from age zero, from birth, all the way up to age 85 or 100. So there is some geographic issues that needs to be addressed at some point in time.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, and that's a good point because I never really thought about that, the geographical locations that we're in. Even if they say that our locations are impoverished, or they may say that it's crime written, us leaders that's in the community, us, you know, believers in humanity, you know, we actually start changing how societies are portrayed and the outlook of our societies, you know, so we can actually, you know, step up and actually put a lot of perspectives into place. So if I go into a nonprofit that's in my society, I suspect them to basically be able to tackle the issues at hand. I've seen personally that issues that the nonprofit is supposed to tackle at hand still exist 10, 15, 20, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years later at the incorporation of the nonprofit. So it's actually showing that these entities are not preserving our communities. They're not increasing our communities. And we as leaders in our communities and as men and women in our communities have responsibilities to basically change the framework of how our societies are viewed. And like Jane was talking about, from a professional standpoint, you know, having coverage for your children, and you know that you live in a crime-ridden and impoverished community, and not having, you know, coverage for your children, not having a safety net for your children, is what I would say, something not to be desired. So with that, you know, I'm just saying that Gene made a great point on the locations that we're living in. Investigate those locations, figure out what policies may or may not exist in the regions that you're about to move in or you actually living in now, to safeguard yourself, you know, from the inevitable that always happens in communities that are not uplifting each other and not building core values.
And you are absolutely correct. I mean, core values is something as a community we have to do. We have to set out to go and do and look into. It's not a one-man show or a one-man event that does that. And we need to come together, get into our community centers, get into places where our parents hang out, you know, playgrounds. I mean, we just have to get the word out there and educate them. And as you have clearly said, and I'm a true believer of what you're saying, is it's happening in the everyday living. It's becoming a norm of seeing our younger generation passing out and or getting involved in activities that the parents are not prepared for. So they don't have what we will call an idea as to what they're getting involved in or what risk they're taking when they do certain things, that's causing a problem or hardship on us as parents. And we need to address these things at our dining room table. Now, some people say gone are the days when people sit and have dinner together as a family. I guess I'm old fashioned because I make it home, or I do my best to be home every day, if not most days, to have dinner with my daughter. When my kids are in town, those that's away in school and or don't live with me, I make it my duty to hit breakfast and hit dinner with them with no tablets and no cell phones. Because we know that today's community, everyone wants to have a piece of the electronic. Because yes. The whole world is going so fast, they think that they're missing something, and the family values are not there. And I'm very concerned about family values and what should be there in the value of a family. Whereas you're able to know and understand by dialoguing, not by texting, not by sending emails or forwarding email, is by dialoguing, by sharing one's opinion, you know? And, you know, there is a hard question where, when do you ask your parent or the parent asks a child what provisions they have made if and when the inevitable happens, you know? How many children, and it has nothing to do with age, it just means that your parents, your mother, your father, both are still alive. How many of them know where they want to be buried versus cremated? How many of them know where's the will for the person? How many of them know where is the medical power of attorney? How many of them know if the parents want to be resuscitated or do not resuscitate it? Do you understand what I'm saying? Those are the hard questions that are not being answered at the dinner table. But in other communities, they have the opportunity of knowing those answers, getting those questions to the answers, so they can know and they can act on it. And then they can learn and prepare themselves for their younger generation, their offspring, their loin, as it would be, to be prepared for these things in the future. And I think that, you know, there's so many other communities that do it. And we need to be more sensitive and aware of it and, you know, have that conversation. It's a hard conversation to have, I agree. Because our principles and values, we never think that we're going to die. But are we making a selfish decision by not having the discussion? Is where my argument would be to you. Are we making a selfish decision not to have the discussion with our children, our grandchildren, for them to know where we are, how we stand, how we would like to move forward? You know, this is stuff that needs to be discussed as a family. It's not only that.
Not at the funerals, you know, like I've been to many funerals and stuff like that where people start asking for money at the funeral or, you know, right before the individual was to pass away. And, you know, people do and have some inkling of some families that have dangerous lifestyles, right? And, you know, they living on the edge, they doing whatever they want to do to survive. A lot of people have turned, you know, what they say this age, entrepreneurs, but not entrepreneurs in the sense that we would say. You know, entrepreneurs actually, you know, selling drugs or getting into other, you know, illicit activities, right? That would actually come back on the family if this individual, you know, was to lose his life or she was to lose her life or whatever. You know, by going to news every day, I seen two brothers got killed in the Bronx today. I seen a brother got killed in the Bronx the other day. Another two brothers got injured with the brother, you know, and you know, another brother, he went to a studio. I guess he was putting a rap song out and somebody killed him in the studio and then went downstairs and killed his friend that was waiting for him, right? And it's just 1 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, you know, so you got predators out there. It ain't like, you know, your family is actually out there, you know, trying to commit crimes and stuff like that. You got predators that's out there. That's using this time, that's using the secrecy of this time, that's using the mass of this time to actually cause harm in our communities. You know what I mean? And life insurance is not just about death. You know, your family may get maimed, you know, lose an arm or lose an leg or lose an eye. You see what I'm saying? And you need substances and tools and resources to help that individual and yourself through that trying time. And we have to be aware of the times that we're in and what's really, you know, taking place. Yeah, we have prayer, we have fasting, we have meditation, you know, but we also need to have wisdom and knowledge on how to protect ourselves when things don't go the way we plan. And how many times do things go the way that we plan? Right? They don't always map out the way that we want them to be. So there's no reason to live a mystical life. We have to live realistic lives. There's no mystery here. We're here, we're breathing, we're talking, we're looking at each other. I'm moving my hands when I want to, right? This is no mystery. I'm here, I'm alive, I'm in the flesh. I'm in a moment at this particular time. And whoever's looking at this video is also in a moment at this particular time. This moment is not going to come back. This moment is one time and one time only. And it's not going to repeat itself, right? So this is all our moments of our lives to really be focused on who we are and what's really taking place around us in our set communities and looking at the laws that's taking place in our communities as well to determine what's happened to some of our youth and how to protect our youth at the same time.
Right, and I am fully in agreement with that. Fully in agreement with that, because it's very important that we understand that life insurance is the preparation. Okay, we're preparing should it happen. And we need to understand that accidental death is called an accident because it happens accidentally. You might be at the wrong place at the wrong time. Or some would say you are at the wrong place at the right time because your time came. Okay? I heard a guy said the other day that he don't travel on planes because what if the pilot time comes and his time didn't come? Oh, what happened? So, I mean, yeah. We can laugh and joke about it now.
Because we
are not in the position and we don't feel the pain. But what happened to people? Okay, I got the best one for you. I got the best scenario to share with our listening audience. You ready? The best. A grandmother, and I started with a grandmother because she died first, died in December of natural causes. She went to sleep and didn't wake up. Great. She leave a life insurance for her daughter and her grandson is the contingent beneficiary. If the daughter dies, it goes to the grandson. Her money. The daughter dies 3 months later from toxic shock syndrome. That's in February. What are we in now? May. In April, the contingent beneficiary had a close call with death. He had a car accident. But a car accident broke his neck. So from his neck down, from his shoulders down, has no life. He can't walk, he can't move, he can't do anything. Can't even go to the bathroom on his own. Now, because he had his mother took out a life insurance for him, the family, his fiance, his other aunt, is able to bring the doctor and the hospital to his home. He just bought a home. He haven't been in the home 6 months. But he's still enjoying his home because of his life insurance, they can pay while the whole case get deciphered and insurance decide who's accepting liability and who's going to pay and who's not going to pay and are they going to go to court? Are they 2 years away from court and a judgment and all that stuff? The life insurance is currently paying. That family get 90% of the face value of the policy. Now, that was an accident. Yes.
That's right.
Some would say, you have a car insurance. Yes, he does.
Yes, true. Okay.
But who is accepting liability for the accident? While the insurance worker defined the details of a settlement, he still has to live.
That's correct.
He still needs to be comfortable. And that is where your life insurance come in, because it doesn't say how you got disabled. It says an accident caused you to get disabled. Okay? Not what caused you to be disabled. It's the element of an accident. It's accidental disability.
Accidental. That's correct.
It didn't happen on the job. Many people tell me, I got a disability insurance from my job. But when you're off the job, are you covered?
No.
Okay? So when I try to educate people, I tell them, this is for all that you don't have. This is all the questions. Just fill the blanks for all the questions that's not answered. You're not on the job. You get in an accident. What happens? You're still covered. You know, I met a guy 2 Wednesdays ago at McDonald's. Okay? I went to McDonald's to have me a hot cup of coffee. The guy was there. The guy's walking. I tried to help him. He fell out of a tree on his own property with a machine that cuts trees.
Mm.
He fell on the machine. The machine was still running.
Ooh.
It slashed his stomach. Guess what? 4 months prior to that, he told me, I got plenty of insurance. I don't need insurance. 4 months. 4 months later, he's saying to me, you still got that insurance? Can I still get it now? It's too late. It's too late. You failed to plan. So these are the things that we try to enlighten the public at large and get into the community, let them understand that this is available. Yeah, we can do this, plan this, and get it. It's very, very cheap. For the younger people to get insurance. I mean, I got as far as 52 years old, you paying under $50 a month for insurance.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Okay? So you got to look at what are you doing with money, what kind of preparation you're making, and what if something happened, are you prepared to deal with it? Can you deal with it? Okay?
Yeah, and that's a really... touchy story, you know, because sometimes, you know, as a professional, you know that it's important for people to actually have coverage and protect themselves and their families. And I've noticed, even as me, you know, being a consultant, of me, you know, working in different industries and stuff like that, is that the message should not determine, it should not be determined because a person is a person's race or the color of a person's skin or something like that. We have to start really trusting each other as people and really building each other up and thereby building our communities up. So, you know, if I come to you and say, yo, this is an important factor for your life, you know, look at it according to your life. Don't look at, oh, he's a black person that's trying to get successful and he's just trying to sell me life insurance, right? No, these components are out here for us to benefit from, right? And it's just like somebody said, oh, you don't vote. Well, you should vote, right? Yeah, there are components where you should vote. You know what I'm saying? There are things that's in your communities, not just for the president, not just for the mayor, not just for the governor. You know what I'm saying? But there's other, you know what I'm saying, legislations in your community that you can vote for that will change the framework of how your community is viewed and what resources actually come inside your community, right? And
I'm a true believer of that, and I agree with that. And I mean, that's a whole different podcast for another time that needs to be addressed by our community.
That's
because
correct.
I think people need to go out and vote, okay, for the community leaders that makes a difference in Congress and in the Senate, because that's the only way the president, present and future presidents, can be able to govern and have some sort of totality as to how and what they're governing over.
That's right.
But at the same time, we need those same senators that has a passion for, I would call a few names, but I won't. I opt not to, because no way I'm politically influenced. But I think that we need to put certain people in office, especially those that are going against corporate America, to bring business and jobs into our community. I think it's very important that we have that. I mean, I tried to do a policy for a child the other day in a specific state, on a specific city, and it's not available. But it's available in other states and other cities for that same age child. And I thought it was appalling.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
These are the things that we need to speak to our community leaders on.
That's right. And why this is not there. Why this is not there, right?
Why is good for some and not good for others.
That's correct. Because if you look at, like, let's say, prison systems, they build prisons to build their communities, right? So we have to start building systems to build our communities and to really understand that we are fundamentally responsible and accountable for making necessary changes in our communities and not allowing things to just run rampant, like no responsibility at all, right? We have to find ways to realize that we are in control to some extent, right? And that what's happening in society is moving without our consent. So we're in communities and we're seeing things that's happening and we're not involved and we're not trying to bring changes about, the people in the community is going to face the consequences. Like I said earlier, if a nonprofit comes to community and does not do the work, it's the people that suffer, not the nonprofit. The nonprofit is still going to get grants. It's still going to be getting their payrolls, but the people in the community is going to suffer.
And I agree with you 100%. I agree with you 150%, because the people in the community need to wake up, stop sleeping, okay, and build our community, be a part of our community. Just don't go home and watch TV. Just don't take a day off to sit at home to watch TV, okay, and look for the next thing, selling the Prada and the Gucci's and those nice things. Those people have made their money and continue making money off of you.
Yes, right. That's right. Okay.
What investments are you making to yourself?
That's correct.
Provisions you're making for your children in your future? To tell me how many red bottoms you have, great. I have none.
Do red bottoms come with scholarships?
It doesn't.
Come with scholarships?
It doesn't.
Do Louis has come with scholarships?
No, it doesn't.
No, none of these things come with anything.
But you want your children to have an education. You want your children to have an education that costs hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Where you get it from?
Exactly.
Where you get it from? You know, I was at Department of Education. You know, they tried to shut down Moreau College like 3 years ago because they said that the students in Moreau College was competing with the Ivy League students. And they tried to shut down the whole Moreau College. We had to go out there and do advocacy to stop them from shutting down Moreau College because they didn't want our children to elevate on the same plane as the other nations of children.
My friend, all I can say to you is that as a community, we need to plan. We need to have people planning. We have to look at where we are, what we want to do, and how we want to do it. You have people like myself who volunteer my time.
I'm very open
to give any advice I can on life insurance and annuities. Anything that I'm involved with that I know about, I would give my professional guidance on. And people need to tap those resources, reach out to me. at 855-411-0424. The number is running at the bottom of the podcast. And let's sit down and dialogue and see how you can best plan for your family. Because your family future is your future, because your family represents you as the head of the household. Each dependent, as they go out there, they look up to you, and they look forward to you doing for them. So that's in good. My opinion, I think that as they're looking forward and looking up to you, you should leave them with a legacy, whereas they can move forward and have something to say, my grandmother did this for me, my mother did that for me. My grandfather did that for me. My grandmother, my grandfather did that for me. My godparents, my uncle, my aunt, my parents did these things for me. And they continued on for their loved ones and future loins.
Yeah, because you know they got this saying that says, don't tell people what you're doing and move in silence, right? You can't move in silence if you got the latest sneakers on, the latest hats and latest jackets, right? You know, you're a billboard, everybody's seeing you, right?
Of course.
Moving in silence is basically setting up fundamental aspects for your life, foundations and structures that will allow you to springboard back on your feet if you ever take a fall, right? And putting things in perspective for your loved ones, right? That's moving in silence. That's basically building, you know what I'm saying, your legacy, as Gene is talking about. And not the legacy of things. There's so many things that's out here. And if you go into these factories that actually make sneakers and make, you know, pants and stuff like that, you will be applauded about these factories. The conditions of these factories, the conditions of the workers inside these factories and stuff like that, the rate of pay and or the frequency of pay inside these factories. And you're sitting here spending $500, $600, $1,000 on an item that only probably cost them $6 to make, right? And I think is imperative to see that the systems that are coming against our income are not here to develop us, right? All these financial institutions, all of these networks of TV and radios and stuff like that, they're not here to build up our communities. They're rebuilding their communities. They keep building their communities. And our communities are basically affected because it's not developing. It's not developing according to laws, according to policies that's in our communities, according to the mindset of how things are supposed to be. Right?
Right.
We buy houses. We don't buy rent. We buy houses. You know what I'm saying? We protect our families. You know what I'm saying? I walk through the streets of Brooklyn, and every day I walk through the streets of Brooklyn, I'm bombarded by the sight of homelessness. It is increasing on a very, very, very high level. I watched something in the news yesterday. One of the founders of Grandmaster Flash was sentenced to 16 years in prison yesterday because he killed a homeless man that was on the streets with a steak knife. He said the homeless man was making passes at him, and he took the man's life. And this man was an icon. This man created Grandmaster Flash. You know what I'm saying? He created these certain groups. And his end was that he was working or a job that made him unhappy. He was in a space that he did not appreciate, and he turned around and took another person's life, right? And it shows preparation is really important. We can lose our legacies out here. People always believe that, you know, they're untouchable, that they can't fall and things can't happen to them. I see it every day. We can lose our legacies. We can lose certain gifts or certain positions that we had. And what's happened to us then? Where do we go from there? This society is showing us, hands down, that preparation and structure are essential. It's essential as that mask when you walk outside and they say it's a mandate. That's how essential is as that mask that you put on your face to protect yourself. This also is to protect yourself. This also is a mask to protect yourself, your life insurance, your annuities. You know what I'm saying? Let your families know all the intricacies that you're going through to make sure they're protected, and letting them know that you actually care about their overall well-being. That's the mask to wear, not the mask that they're talking about, this physical plastic paper mask they have, but the mask of our lives and how to protect ourselves and safeguard, you know, who we are and the things that we actually built for and work for in society, and not just give it away to things.
Well, I am fully, fully in agreement with you, and I hope you can respect that the element of trust that society need to have in the community is very important, that they are following the trends that are being set in real life to put out the real substance out there to protect their family, to have a legacy, and preparing a legacy for their family, because there's a lot of people that are dying. I mean, good, death is going to slow, according to statistics, death is going to slow down a little bit in the, usually should slow down in the summertime. Usually should slow down in the summertime. But what happened in the winter? Yeah, it's going to be back on the rise, okay? But then I got good news and bad news. Troubled cities like Atlanta, Los Angeles, New York, Brooklyn, New York, the Bronx. When it gets warm and people have nowhere to go and nothing to do and they walk around aimlessly. When the nights are shorter and the days are longer, you know, people get out there and they get involved in things. These families, I mean, I looked the other day on the TV, I'm not sure where it was, where a child was in her bed sleeping and a bullet came in the house and killed that child.
That's right. I saw that.
Was that parent prepared for that?
No.
Was that parent ready for that? They didn't know that that was going to happen. The answer is no. When do you start preparing for your loved ones? When you start preparing for the future of your loved ones?
When you realize they're your loved ones.
When do you realize that they're your loved one?
Right? That's when you got, yeah. Because you say that they're your loved one. You say, I love you, this, that. You're using these nice little words, right? But where do you protect, you know what I'm saying, one another? You know, start that process.
So that, I think that we need to be more aware of it and do something about it.
That's right.
That would be advantageous to ourselves and our family. So I don't know who needs to hear this or what, but I think that it's something that needs to be said. It's a conversation that needs to be had by every household and every family, because it's very, very important that we all know death is imminent. As long as you're born, you have to die. Okay? The question is, would you be dying with your dignity and pride by not putting a burden on your family to take care of your final remains?
That's the question.
That's the real question.
That's the real question. So we got like 2 minutes left, guys. And we just wanted to make sure that we do a recap from the last one. You know, Gene will be joining me, you know, periodically, you know, once a week, once every 2 weeks, as his schedule, you know, permits him, because he's doing a lot and he's actually informative. He really cares about his community, his people. And you would notice that if something was to happen to you and you're in a policy with Gene, that he's actually going to do everything he can to make sure that you and your family is safeguarded. And, you know, that personal touch is really important in these times. Being familiar with people that you want to do business with and getting knowledge. You know, this knowledge right here is free. No one's paying for this. I don't get money per ad, per click. I don't get anything. This is free knowledge and free information that people can apply. They can apply it with Gene. They can apply it somewhere else, but it's just out there. It's for you to grab, for you to hear to, and for you to protect yourself, you know, and not to be stubborn with the development of your life, right? Nobody is a psychic. The other day, a young boy, 19 years old, was in a BMW, and he was going 151 miles an hour.
Wow.
Residential street. He ran into six people and killed them instantly. And he survived.
No, really?
He survived. And no one's prepared for a man to come out of the block in his car, because everybody fascinated with these cars and they want to speed fast, 151 miles an hour. There's no way to prepare for that. You don't know what men are thinking, what's in men's hearts, what's in men's souls. You know, you don't know. All you got to do is pay attention to what's happening to you, the inklings that come to you, the decision-making process that comes to you, and put those things in perspective. So if anything was to take place in your life, you'll have some cushion to fall back on and know that your family's protected. Even if you was to, you know, succumb to the situation, your family would actually be protected.
Right. And I can only echo what Nathan is saying. It's true. That's why I got into this field. That's why I got into this industry, to help families, okay? To help families, and I hope that everyone take on board that we're doing this podcast. There is no fee payment or anything like that. But it's all taken care of, and by us, we stand all the expenses to do it, because we believe in our community, and we believe in having our community protected, so we don't have to always hear the sad stories and eliminate the amount of sad stories we hear from our community. With this, I say thank you very much for having me. I do appreciate it, Nathan. And I sure will be hearing from you again.
That's right. Thanks a lot. And this is very informative. And have a good night, Gene. And
thank you, buddy. Good night. Stay well.
Good night. Be well.
Good night.